May 14th, 1883. I received a most curious missive in the post this morning. It has been 4 months since I returned to England, having nearly lost my life in endeavoring to become the first man to reach the summit of the foreboding and deadly Mount Everest. I have spent the time since in research and recovery here in London, nursing my wounds and documenting my memoirs of the harrowing trip up the mountain and my nearly fatal encounter with the creature I found there, and have not planned to embark again for distant shores until after summer has passed. That has changed, I fear, as the result of today's letter.
To Lord Theodore Thomas Blackwood, CBE. Colonel Joseph Deafante, the Armée de Terre of the Republic of France, does hereby cordially invite you to participate in the hunt of a great and terrible creature that threatens the lives of thousands. The Tarrasque, a creature great and terrifying, of late believed to be legend, has risen and threatens the security of the land of Provence and France itself. Colonel Deafante has been authorized by the President of the Republic to pay a sum of 5 million English pounds to the man or men who shall slay this infamous beast.
I immediately dashed off an acceptance and sent it out with the afternoon post. I have always been a firm believer in the proposition that even in the most preposterous of myths, there lies a kernel of truth. Whether an ancient behemoth that breathed fire was bringing ruination to the south of France, I knew not. But I knew that the army and the president themselves were concerned enough to seek out a man such as myself, and were willing to offer a bounty that would finance a score of proper expeditions for the killing of a single beast. May 20th, 1883. We disembarked in Avignon. Mr. Roosevelt and I spent many hours sharing our tales of adventure. I find in him a true intellectual who understands what it means to be a naturalist. I did my best to avoid speaking to Mr. Harris during the trip. I intend during our expedition to be no less than a gentleman, but the man leaves a sour taste in my mouth. May 21st, 1883. Avignon itself looked like a city at war. Soldiers patrolling the streets, barricades at the edge of town. Not far outside the city, we reached the edge of the quarantine zone. Soldiers had been hard at work digging trenches, erecting fortifications. The young men keeping watch looked battle-scarred, as though they had seen indescribable horror. I asked on passing if any of them had yet seen the Tarrasque. Only a few, the scouts and lookouts, had seen it from a distance, I was told, for nobody who had engaged the beast at close range was still alive. We set up camp on the edge of the dead town. Mr. Harris returned by evening and informed us he had spotted the Tarrasque to the southwest, near the village of Bellegarde, in the act of destroying a farmhouse. Its route, he said, had not been difficult to trace, for a swath of barren land seemed to lay a trail. Harris and I, lying in wait out of sight, joined Mr. Roosevelt at the pit's edge and unleashed the full fury of our armaments onto it. Our rifles and shotguns, the particle destabilizer, Mr. Ducor's electric rifle, and the pitchblende gun. The monster let loose a screech from the pits of damnation itself, as bullets and explosives tore its flesh loose, bit by bit, and jellied kerosene burned slowly and stopped it regrowing. By the time the fires had died down, a charred skeleton was all that remained. We have separated the beast's massive skull, blackened and perforated, from what remains of the monster, and a handful of soldiers are hard at work filling in the pit with earth. Tomorrow we shall bring the skull back to Avignon and collect our reward. May 30th, 1883. We were hailed as heroes by the army when we arrived in Avignon with our prize. In the morning light, the Tarrasque skull seemed whiter than it had the night before, and more charred flesh stuck to it than it had seemed when we dragged it from the pit, though surely it was little more than an illusion. The four of us posed for photographs, and Mr. Dukov asked to have his photograph taken with his head in between the massive jaws of our fallen prey. Imagine our horror when the jaws snapped shut, severing Dukov's head neatly at the shoulders. The skull of the Tarrasque rolled loose from its place on the stage and snapped again, taking another chunk of his body, and the soldier screamed and fainted as it seemed to be growing a new coating of flesh and scales over its charred exterior. We watched, shocked, as the honor guards fired a volley at the skull. The chips it took off seemed to replace themselves instantly, and I was dumbfounded as sinew and muscles seemed to spread across the creature's bones and knit into shape. The jaws of the disembodied Tarrasque opened, and it shouted in French. The rest of the Tarrasque, covered in earth and grime, held together by a few lonely strands of muscle, lurched through the square with uncanny speed, trampling men in its path, ignoring gunshot and cannon fire as it made to rejoin its head. I returned to my house in London this afternoon, and was informed by Deeds that a postcard had arrived for me this morning. The handwriting in the brief unsigned note within resembled that of the strange Englishman who had attended the questionings, whose notes I caught brief glimpses of from time to time. I present that message below.
To Lord Theodore Thomas Blackwood, CBE. The Royal Foundation for the Security, Containment, and Protection of Anomalous Objects and Phantasmagoria requests a meeting for the purpose of negotiating an alliance favorable to both our parties. Please call any time, excepting Sundays, at number 19 Melbourne Road, Westminster, and ask to speak to Dr. Thursday. Your discretion is requested in this matter.
I have not heard of this foundation before, and I do not know if I intend to take them up on their mysterious overture. Perhaps I shall hear them out, but I have never been one to serve in one man's employ for very long.